Bonsoir. Mesdames et messieurs, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Ursula Goebel. I'm the Associate Vice President for the Social Science Humanities Research Council, and I'm a proud member of the board of the Institute for Public Administration of Canada, the National Capital Region Chapter. And on behalf of IPAC and NCR and all my fellow board members, it is my true pleasure to welcome you all to this very special event. I would like to acknowledge that our gathering this evening is taking place on the unceded territory of the Algonquin peoples. And we thank the Algonquin peoples for welcoming us today. Tonight we have gathered to listen and to participate in a dialogue on the theme of building capacity in the understanding of reconciliation with Indigenous peoples. C'est le premier événement de 2007, le premier d'une série de qui seront organisés cette année par le chapitre de la région de la capitale nationale de l'IRPC pour appuyer l'engagement de l'IRPC en faveur d'une année nationale de dialogue. I encourage everyone to use this official hashtag as well. It is my great pleasure to first introduce Elder Claudette Kananda, an Algonquin Anishinaabe Anishinaabe First Nation, whom we are honored to have with us this evening to give an opening prayer. Elder Kananda is an alumni of the University of Ottawa Faculty of Common Law and Faculty of Arts. She is dedicated the last 30 years promoting First Nations people, history, culture, and rights in various capacities as a University of Ottawa student, a professor, and member and chair of the Aboriginal Education Council and the Public Forum through public speaking engagements. She's a professor at the Institute of Women's Studies, the Faculty of Education, the Faculty of Law, and the Aboriginal Studies program. She teaches courses on First Nations women, Native education, First Nations people and history, Indigenous traditions, and decolonization. In addition, Elder Kananda is the Executive Director of the First Nations Confederacy of Cultural Education Centers, a national organization which protects, promotes, and revitalizes First Nations culture and languages via traditional knowledge and education. She's inducted into the Common Law Honor Society, served two terms on the Board of Governors for the First Nations University of Canada. She's served three elected terms on the Kitiganzidi Band Council. Elder Kananda is the proud mother of four children and grandmother of 10 children. Elder Kananda,
I present this tobacco and ask for your prayer for good dialogue, sharing of knowledge, and coming together as we commit to building greater understanding and reconciliation.
Before we turn it over to our panel, it's my sincere pleasure to welcome Danielle Poulin, the president of IPAC NCR, to the podium to share a few words. Madame Poulin a été élue présidente du conseil d'administration de l'Institut de l'administration publique du Canada pour la région de la capitale nationale de Denise. Madame Poulin a travaillé au service du gouvernement fédéral, provincial et territorial et occupe présentement à titre de conseillère exécutive à la direction générale des ressources humaines, environnement et changement climatique Canada. Daniel,
oui. Good evening, everyone. Bonsoir à toutes et à tous. Dear panelists, Dr. Franks, Monsieur Lussier, Ms. Scott, Mr. Thoppil, and Mrs. MacQuarrie, Mesdames et Messieurs. It is my great pleasure to welcome each of you at this important event titled Building Capacity in the Understanding of Reconciliation with Indigenous Peoples, organized by the Institute of the Public Administration of Canada in the National Capital Region, also known as IPAC-NCR. As you may already know, IPAC is an organization that was created in 1947 and whose mandate is to promote excellence in public administration in Canada. IPAC is present in 19 regions across the country, and today is a special day for IPAC. In fact, tonight is the first event in the country that opens the IPAC National Year of Dialogue for Reconciliation and Renewed Relationships. Governments and other public institutions across Canada are mobilizing to respond to calls for reconciliation and new relationships with Indigenous peoples. Colleagues here in Ottawa are certainly well aware of the high priority the current government places on building better relationships with First Nations, Métis, and Inuit people. IPAC is providing its strong support to this national challenge with a year-long focus on building relationships with our Indigenous colleagues for better policy and program results through shared learning events and dialogue. As Canada celebrates its 150th birthday, we see this as a meaningful way to acknowledge the progress made, learn from good relationships already built, and to create and identify opportunities for better future relationships as a contribution to the unfinished business of Confederation. As a public servant, I also have the role to promote diversity and inclusion in my work environment. I am of the opinion that we all win when we all help create a world that is better for everyone. I'm taking this opportunity to thank Ursula Gobel, and the Social Sciences and Humanities Research Council of Canada representatives from the board and also from the IMPACT team that have organized this important event. I also want to thank Catherine MacQuarrie, our source of inspiration. Catherine, you do a wonderful job. Before I end my welcoming words tonight, I would like to inform you that IPAC and CR will hold its national conference in 2020. This is a major event for the field and the practice of public administration from coast to coast to coast and from all jurisdictions. For that occasion, we will mobilize as many partners as possible, and I can only think about the important role that the Indigenous peoples' representatives can play during that major event. Je vous remercie à l'avance de votre aide et de votre soutien à cet égard. So, dear panelists, this is an invitation to work hand in hand so we can all together leave our mark at the IMPACT National Conference in 2020. As a conclusion, I invite every participant to share their experience and to listen and learn from the different concepts and realities that will be exposed today. These complementary differences will lead each of us to create a country that is better for everyone. Now I would like to invite Catherine MacQuarrie to act as our moderator. Catherine is the senior executive at IPAC, and I take this opportunity also to thank you all and ask you please to enjoy this moment. This is a very special moment tonight. Bonne soirée à tous et merci d'être venu nous rencontrer.
Ok, on y va. Bonjour tout le monde. Monsieur, madame. Bonsoir. Good evening, everyone. I can't tell you what a personal pleasure it is for me being here tonight moderating. At IPAC, getting this year launched is part of my work, and so I was really delighted when Danielle and Ursula asked me to moderate this very first event here in Ottawa. Elder Commander Chinigwich for your opening words tonight. Always bringing good spirits into whatever room you're in. Thank you. So, just over 1 year ago, Canadians were asked to face kind of an awful truth about ourselves and our country. That the kind and caring and open society that we like to think we are within our country and within the world is not what First Nations peoples, what the Métis, and what Inuit have experienced in Canada in the last 150 years, nor what they continue to experience even today on a daily basis. Life experiences that too often have too much human despair. And the commander talked about the children, that even the lives of children are so full of despair. And for that, we need to be worried, we need to be concerned, and I'm so glad to see so many people here tonight to talk about these issues. The Truth and Reconciliation Report last December in 2015 was in fact just one of a number of national reports in our history, asking Canada to confront its history and to improve relationships with Indigenous peoples. In fact, 20 years ago now, it was the Royal Commission on Aboriginal Peoples who also said a new relationship was urgent and necessary, and that we needed one based on recognition, respect, caring, and responsibility. You know, since the TRC's report last year, I personally have found it quite gratifying to in fact see a real awakening going on in our country. It's slow but sure, but there are an increasing number of people, political leaders, celebrities, many public institutions across the country, universities, colleges, that are prepared to get to work, as Gord Downie asked us to do last summer, on the business of reconciliation. But I think, certainly as I talk to colleagues, big questions about how do we start, where do we start, as individuals and our work, particularly as public servants, for those of you here who are in the public service. Because if we don't work in a job directly related to Indigenous peoples, do we really still have an obligation to inform ourselves about history and about the issues? To be familiar with the public policy and practices that continue even today that brought us to this point? Why did the TRC specifically call for education of public servants? And not just education and information, they said we needed skills development in things like intercultural competency, conflict resolution, human rights, and anti-racism. So how do we get down to this work in the face of sometimes overwhelming complexity as well? And we're very lucky tonight to have four panelists who are going to help us address some of these questions, begin to talk through them. I don't think we'll finish this conversation tonight, but with the expertise here, we're going to make a good start. So the format is that I get to warm up our panelists with a couple of questions first, and then we really do want to leave as much time as possible to open it up to questions from the group and have a dialogue in this room. As Ursula mentioned, we have a Twitter hashtag. We encourage you to tweet, but please tweet responsibly and respectfully. And we should note also that the panel's being video recorded so that we can play it on our website at IPAC for others in the future. Je dois mentionner aussi que ce soir, la plupart de notre discussion se déroulait en anglais, mais pendant la période de questions, je vous invite bien sûr de poser votre question dans le langue de votre choix. Et nous pouvons aider avec la traduction pour nos invités. So please join me in welcoming, without further ado, Dr. Aaron Franks, immediately to my right here. He's the SSHRC visiting fellow in Indigenous Research and Reconciliation. Hubert Lussier, Assistant Deputy Minister, Citizenship, Heritage and Region Sector at Heritage Canada. Kimberly Scott, Director of Research and Policy Coordination, Assembly of First Nations. And Paul Thoppil, Interim Senior Assistant Deputy Minister, Policy and Strategic Direction, and CFO, Indigenous and Northern Affairs Canada. Also joining Paul tonight is David Dendoven, who's here in the front row. Unfortunately, Paul has to get on a plane tonight to go to Vancouver for a joint gathering of BC First Nations, and so David's going to help us out once we get to the question period if Paul has to slip out by that point. So my first question is the same for each one of you. And really to give the audience a sense of your work and where you come from, to talk about the intersections of the work that you do currently with reconciliation, and also share with us, if you could, whether you have kind of a personal working definition of reconciliation that you bring to the students. So Aaron, we'll start with you.
Okay, thanks very much, Catherine. I really want to settle into enjoying the relaxed conversational setup we have here, but I'm a little anxious and there's some key points I want to touch on, so I've got my little crib sheet here as well. And I also find myself surprising myself at how emotional the past half hour has been, and I want to honor that and let that happen, but also in a broader sense, I think some of what I have to say will touch on the fact that it's not about me, and it's not always about our own feelings on these topics. It's our positionality towards reconciliation is much more complex than that. But just to start off here, I'm a postdoctoral researcher at SSHRC. I'm not employed by SSHRC. I've been invited as a guest through the MITACS Canadian Science Policy Fellowship Program to be a sort of embedded critical friend, fellow investigator, fellow thinker through as SSHRC works through TRC Call to Action 65, which tasks SSHRC with advancing understanding of reconciliation. Not advancing reconciliation per se, it's a little language thing I think is important. Social sciences and humanities have a role in allowing all kinds of critical perspectives to flourish. I'm actually a human geographer. My work focuses on social movements, and I think the important thing there is I foundationally believe that we are equally always forming our social and physical environments at the same time. So government, the natural world, these things aren't separate. I also have a background in theater and performance, and I see the world still in that way. I think we are engaged always with our bodies and our emotions and our intellects and our spirits, and that's interpersonally and in terms of community and in terms of the way we govern ourselves in society. So when I consider reconciliation, I consider land and our bodies and our communities and our emotional and spiritual well-being as well. I'm also of mixed European, Métis, and Mushkego Cree background. I was not raised in an Indigenous cultural community. I did not have that connection. I think I have a growing connection, and for a long time I've had a connection to the knowledge of the impacts of mobility, migration, displacement, and colonialism in a fractured kind of way on my family background. And as I've matured intellectually, I guess, in my knowledge of my place in the world and the country, I can see myself connected very much to the story of colonialism in Canada. So when I consider reconciliation, I also consider this foundational relationship and this continuing relationship in our country of exploitation of land and of people and of labor as well. And these threads, personal and political and intellectual, came together the past two or three years as I worked with the Center for Indigenous Research Creation and now at SSHRC. So I guess just to polish that off, I'm a combination of a learner and an advisor and a constructive critic at SSHRC, and I'm very privileged to have this seat at their table participating as a guest. And I guess I see my main role among many as advocating for distinct spaces for Indigenous research and research administration. And I think these are possible, and I think these distinct autonomous spaces will actually promote and not undermine true collaboration towards reconciliation. And if I have a definition of reconciliation that I work from, it's a very active one. I think it begins with Indigenous autonomy and self-determination, and that's based on a nation-to-nation relationship founded in living treaty rights, constitutional and international Indigenous rights. And I think that is an end in itself, whether we want to call it reconciliation or not, but if achieved, it will also mark a flourishing for this territory as a whole, for Indigenous and non-Indigenous people alike.
So your question, Catherine, is to state the reason you invited me to this event, which has to do with the fact that I work for a department that has culture, sports, languages within its mandate. And these are all issues that have been affected, and the legacy of which we still live today, by residential schools. It also happens to be the topic of 15 of the calls to action of the report, Truth and Reconciliation report. Therefore, the intersection is clearly because I have to work, and I'm really proud to be working for an institution that will, I hope, play an important part in the process of reconciliation and providing an answer to some of the important calls to action. I personally also, I'm responsible for a sector of this department that is responsible for languages. I have a little program that focuses on indigenous languages and culture and broadcasting, which we hope can grow, improve, and make better with the partnership of indigenous representatives. The definition that I have is close to what Aaron mentioned. My own spin on it is that to repair, which is important to what I think reconciliation means, the repair of the damage done by the residential schools and the other policies done over the last 150 years, has to lead to something which is sustainable, a process which is sustainable, and which includes a form of we working together. Indigenous, non-Indigenous, new Canadians, institutions within the government, all institutions, while respecting the specificities that we have, that this process involves a sense of.
Thank you.
Kim? So as Director of Research and Policy Coordination at the Assembly of First Nations, I have the privilege of supporting our National Chief, Harry Bellegarde, as well as the executive in their efforts to hold all Canadian institutions to account for the Truth and Reconciliation calls to action. If there's a working definition of reconciliation, it is the implementation and adoption without qualification of the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, as well as the implementation of the TRC calls to action. So what does that look like on the ground? Well, it looks like morally independent, self-directing freedom supported by fair resource revenue sharing agreements with Indigenous peoples in Canada. It looks like it's the same opportunities and life outcomes that every other Canadian enjoys for our children and our youth. It looks like set-asides in clean energy investments for the future, because we know that there is an enormous energy transition underway, and we are not to be left out of this energy transition. In fact, if equity remains a tenet of Canadian nationalism, there should be set-asides to ensure that those diesel-dependent communities now that face inordinate challenges in functioning in their day-to-day lives are the first to get energy-efficient infrastructure as well as green energy installations in ways that they own. It looks like kitchen table conversations where all Canadians are committed to a better tomorrow, where there is open space where we're granted to be who we are, and to manage our affairs in ways that feel right and work better. So again, underscoring the importance of moral independence from the imposition. It looks like treaty recognition. It looks like the acknowledgement of unceded Algonquin territory. And so there is enormous momentum everywhere. There's enormous goodwill. I think, you know, we get 250 invitations every day for people wanting our voice. We cannot keep up with the demand. There's an opening like I've never seen in my lifetime. So we hope to be able to take the fullest advantage of this opening We look to all of you to help us in this quest, but I hope that I've shaped or imagined what reconciliation looks like for us.
Perfect. Paul, last word.
Thank you. It's an exciting time, definitely, to be, as a federal civil servant, to be in the public policy space that is Indigenous. And it's great, in part because the tone is set always by the government. And you know, the Prime Minister has made it abundantly clear that there is no relationship more important to him and to Canada than the one with Indigenous peoples. So that sets, as a civil servant, the frame for all your actions going forward. And for me, being an Indigenous Northern First, it's truly motivating and energizing. I think at IDAC, we define reconciliation as the ongoing process of establishing and maintaining mutually respectful relationships between First Nations, Inuit, and Métis, and non-Indigenous peoples. A nation to nation, a crown to Inuit, a government to government relationship from the Métis perspective. A renewed fiscal relationship with Indigenous groups, closing those enduring socioeconomic gaps. And widespread engagement with Indigenous partners in the development of new policies and programs. But my own personal definition is a little bit more simpler than, I guess, the official one. I think at the heart of it, my own view is that reconciliation is a respectful relationship. So what does that mean? I think it means an ongoing engagement with Indigenous peoples on the issues that concern them. So it's about questioning, engaging, listening, and implementing what you hear from them.
Thank you. Just going to dive a little bit deeper in terms of the work that each of you do and some of your perspectives on it, and then we'll turn it over for questions from the floor. Hubert, you talked about this tremendous new challenge you have in terms of an Indigenous Languages Act, which the Prime Minister announced in December at the Special Chiefs Assembly. Having worked in Native broadcasting and being well aware that there are somewhere around the neighborhood of 60 distinct Indigenous languages in this country, never mind all the associated dialects on top of that, 60 distinct cultures, any multiple jurisdictions and any number of self-governing entities, this is going to be one heck of a challenge. And I'm wondering what is the early thinking in your department in terms of how you will support the drafting of the legislation in a way that also supports reconciliation and new relationships and clearly as a I'm no doubt that you want to try and make it an inclusive process going forward, but any early thoughts on how you're going to undertake that?
Sure. My answer is part of a work in progress, as we don't yet have all the answers. And the reason is, not only does the content of what the legislation need to be defined in partnership with Indigenous people, but the very process is rather.
Yeah,
my mic doesn't work. Is it better like this?
We lost our sound.
Is it better like this?
No.
Yeah.
There you go.
Okay. So it's a work in progress. We also need to define the process. So we have to jointly arrive at how we're going to do it. And I'm fairly new in that area, in the sense that my experience with drafting legislation is you get out in the field, you consult, you listen what the stakeholders have to say, then you get back into your room, and based on your own intelligence analysis, you draft something which goes to cabinet, which gives you the authority for the justice lawyers to draft legislation. By then, the stakeholders are in another room and they don't hear from us at all. They only hear when finally the draft bill is tabled in parliament. And then they get to kick at the can once more. obviously that's not the way it will happen this time. The Prime Minister was quite clear in his announcement, this is going to be co-development. Therefore, the notion that it's a process where we politely listen, then we leave the room, and we draft whatever we think is best, has to be something different. It won't work like that. Obviously, one of the things that is a given is that people, experts representing the Assembly of First Nations, the Council, ITK for the Inuit people, need to be part of the process where we conceive this piece of legislation. And apart from that, Kim and I were having discussions just before the meeting. Well, it's pretty much of a blank sheet. I understand that the notion of co-development has been used in certain instances by our colleagues in INAC, with whom we will obviously be in close collaboration along with Justice in this process. But for an issue like which is as far-reaching as indeed languages, of which there are 60, if not 90, depending on how you count, indeed, Catherine. I don't think something as ambitious as that has ever been done, and at least for my department, that's certainly the case. It is a new enterprise. So I'll be glad to hear questions and suggestions that we have, but you know, the first rule of this book that needs to be written is in partnership with the representative organizations and us from the government. That's key to the success.
Just before you put the microphone down, what guidance or sort of principles, you mentioned you've got that sort of one first rule around partnership, but what guidance or principles are you talking about with your teams about how you might embark on this? I mean, I imagine it's new for you. It would be new for many folks in your organization.
Well, one of the important things is that we have to, I think right from the start, share what we know and don't know about each other's wishes and priorities. We start from a basis where the Truth and Reconciliation has given us some guidance of what legislation should include. There's notion of a commissioner, that's key, and we have to respect that. And you know, to be frank, one of the things we'll have to set from the start is Paul and I and our colleagues will have to do some check-ins from time to time, just like Kim will have to do. Are we on the right path? And we'll have to be transparent with each other. This is a time when we need to do some check-ins with our respective masters. So a degree of transparency and respect on what step we think we are at and whether we need to go back to some of our mandataires, I have the word in English, is going to be important so that there are no surprises or as little surprises as possible during the process.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Kim, are you okay to go next?
Like me, you're still suffering from it. So, you talked about the work that you're doing with the Assembly of First Nations, and I would imagine, I imagine you out there really kind of on the front lines with a lot of tables with provincial, federal employees, public servants, policy wonks. And I'm just wondering what you're observing. So you talked a little bit about the number of invitations and that you are seeing a lot of a willingness and interest. But what are you actually observing in the day-to-day work, in how public servants are being? Do you see a change in attitudes, practice, process, what concretely, and also what's missing still for you in those relationships?
So there is a lot of effort on behalf of all Canadian institutions, not just governments. And what seems to be occurring is there's a lot of investment in the policy development part of that cycle, and even in getting on the agenda for people to make decisions that would provide an institutional guard for languages, for example. But we don't yet seem to get to policy adoption and implementation. So we're thwarted there. I think that there's some kind of bridge that we need to cross to actually have policies adopted, like the CHRT ruling. Why is it that we're still stalled on providing fair access to our most vulnerable children? So despite the fact that we have enormous pressure by Canadian institutions like the Canadian Human Rights Tribunal, why is it that we're not there yet? So lots of engagement, lots of conversation, but not yet enough in terms of creating policies that get adopted and implemented, and even policy maintenance. So we're thrilled by the Indigenous Languages Act, because we believe that that will be an unassailable protection, even if only it provides institutional guard for all Indigenous languages, so that no further government can then erase that unassailable protection. But we don't get to policy maintenance in very many places. The other opportunity I think we have before us is, and the TRC does call for this, is some kind of an Indigenous Child Protection Act. So even in our own case, we are tinkering with a tertiary system that addresses our children who are at greatest risk, but why aren't we talking about reducing that risk to begin with some kind of Indigenous Child Protection Act? So I think that that's probably about, in general terms, where we can lead this, but we need to break through to get to policy adoption, implementation, and maintenance.
Is your sense that people are still sort of trying to learn or trying to understand from another world perspective how to do some of this stuff?
There's enormous goodwill, and I think it's true that people don't really understand where to begin, who to go to, who to consult. And I would offer you the opportunity to speak with us or with other national Indigenous organizations, but also to work at a community level. Reconciliation is going to play out on the ground between municipalities and First Nations, or between Indigenous communities and other Canadians, in faith-based places, in community organizations, in sporting events, in town halls. It will not necessarily play out on the national level completely. So I think there's enormous goodwill, but not enough understanding of where to go. So I just say, take the risk and reach out wherever you can.
Well, on the topic of people who are still learning, I hope I'm not putting you too badly on the spot here, Paul, but we did talk about this previously. And the fact that, you're still relatively new to what is now not just one, but two senior roles within Indigenous Northern Affairs. You have a very expert background in international relations. I'm wondering if you would be willing to talk a little bit about kind of your personal experiences of coming into such a new and complex area, your own sort of learning journey in that, but also what you might have wished you'd known as a younger public servant, or wish you had learned as a younger public servant that would have prepared you better for some of these responsibilities.
Thank you, Catherine, for the question. I think that's quite correct. I think I have been on a tremendous personal learning journey since I've arrived at IMAC for the past couple of years. It's really changed really the personal fiber of my being in terms of understanding the nation that I was born and raised in, and understanding truly the history and its best moments, and also some of its very worst moments as well, by working at the department and understanding the intersection between Indigenous and non-Indigenous peoples going forward. But it's been fascinating, and I feel I'm the better for it. If I had to think about my career, I actually would like to do a redo it. And in fact, I would actually think that I have my own personal my own personal commentary would be I almost think that almost every federal civil servant should have as a basis before starting any of their job is in fact trying to go through at least a bit of a stint through Indigenous and Northern Affairs, just to kind of have that indoctrination of understanding the true foundings of our country and its dark chapters, and some of our challenges that we still have to muster as we go through other parts of the federal service through our career. When I reflect upon my, you know, representing Canada abroad and representing Canada's positions abroad in different bilateral forums, you know, I think it's important to understand the fact that there are, you know, issues of reconciliation in your own country as you're in other countries, whether it's China or so on, trying to address socioeconomic gaps in other countries that we're working away from, but also the ones that are also, quite frankly, within our own. And I think you're just a better overall federal civil servant or international representative for your nation if you know your strengths as well as your weaknesses of your country when engaging. I mean, I think there's some practical issues as well. I think when I was based in Japan and encouraging Japanese investment in the mineral energy space, I would have been a little bit more articulate on the duty consult. and then some other snippets like that. Maybe I wouldn't have been so vocal with my Chinese counterparts on human rights violations, maybe. But I digress. But I do feel that the brief stint that I've had at INEC has been a tremendous formation. And I do feel that other civil servants need to at least do a bit of a mini stint in the department as a bit of a grounding for what they will do going forward. I'm, you know, part of a process of trying to being a committee of on Canada 150, and of course one of the things that we're trying to do is ensure that there are some certain minimums of protocols that we implement in all of these events that will be celebrated from coast to coast to coast. And we talk about the importance of notwithstanding where we are in those events that we celebrate the official languages, but to take a page from Hubert, it's, well, why just the official languages? When we talk about our roots of our 150 years, I mean, there should be as well at those events, the celebration and the articulation of that territorial language as well, and the indoctrination or the incorporation of those events of the local territorial traditions and cultures as well, as part of that opportunity for reconciliation through Canada 150 and make Canada 150 that turning of the page of what transpired over the past 150 years and make sure that we don't do that again and we walk a different journey. It's a little bit more positive.
Thank you. So one last question, Aaron, this time, and then we'll turn it over to everyone else. Aaron, you talked about colonization earlier, and I'd like you to just come back on that, because I remember reading something that you said about reconciliation cannot happen without decolonization. But I also saw something else that I was really like a bit more of an explanation of, and you said that you felt the greatest threat to this moment of reconciliation in Canada that Paul just referred to is not dissensus or conflict, but that reconciliation becomes a filter through which business as usual practices and policies are passed largely unaltered and legitimated on the other side. So can you talk a little bit about what concretely you see as that threat?
Sure. Is this?
Yeah.
This, all right. Good. This is from I was invited. Really fortunate to be invited to the 20th the conference in Winnipeg back in November, marking the 20th anniversary of the Royal Commission on Aboriginal Peoples, and I was invited to write a sort of a think piece on. And Catherine's quoting from that. I think one way of summing up what I mean by that. I was thinking, you know, what are these various threats? Am I just being paranoid? And generally, communication does not equal reconciliation. And I think there's a tendency to fall into this trap of dialogue, a hunger to listen, a hunger to know, that becomes a substitute for, as Elder Commander would say, reconciliation. And I see that happening in lots of different ways. And maybe three concrete examples. One would be, you know, regardless of what you think of Kinder Morgan and the Trans Mountain Pipeline, I think it's an abuse of the term reconciliation to say consultation with First Nations communities leading to the approval was, in quote, the spirit of reconciliation. I think that was a phrase used in the formal announcement. I think to take an existing duty to consult and tag reconciliation onto it is a rhetorical dodge. That's one way that communications substitute for reconciliation. Another way, and I think it's more difficult to talk about, it's probably why we should talk about it, is, for example, certain creative work that's going on around Chani Wenjack and his death. I think of Gord Downie, and I have tremendous respect for him as an artist. I mean, I'm in my mid-40s. I love the Tragically Hip. I grew up with Tragically Hip. I respect him as a poet. My father had the same illness as Gord does. And I can only imagine the deep emotional and, as I think we're hearing, spiritual connection he has to Gord's, to Chani's sister and their family in northwestern Ontario. But our hunger to listen and communicate is taking up a lot of space, and it's taking up a lot of space in the public sphere around what reconciliation is. And the third thing I want to point out, people have mentioned ITK, Inuit, Tapir, Kanatami. I heard Natan Obed speak at this conference in Winnipeg, and one thing he said just resonates with me still. He said, speaking about, you know, this hunger to listen, this hunger to know, and in practical terms that means a lot of non-Indigenous researchers going to the Arctic and saying, you know, we hear these problems around suicide, food security, water, we're here to help. In a sense, inadvertently ignoring the decades of thought and care and work that ITK and other organizations have done. And he said, if you want to live this claim you have of respect, it's not about coming up here to listen, it's about accept our positions, was his word. And it's, we've done this work, we've put in the blood and the sweat and the thought. If you want to, that's a baseline, we start there. So I guess that's three specific examples of communication as a substitution for reconciliation. Did I answer the question?
You did indeed. Yeah. Thank you. All right, you guys got enough to go on now? It's question time or comment time, depending on which. Yeah, we've got two microphones. Clap your hand and someone will come running with it. If you wouldn't mind introducing yourself, it's not absolutely necessary, but it would be nice to know who you are and who you'd like to address your question to.
So hi there everyone, my name is Jared Westlink. I'm an undergraduate student here at the University of Ottawa, but I also serve as the executive director of an organization called the Youth Arctic Coalition. I was involved in helping Attawapiskat prepare for the meeting with the Prime Minister earlier in June, and I was raised by a mental health counselor, spent 25 years working in the 49 Anishinaabe asking First Nation communities in northwestern Ontario. Kind of one of the themes, I suppose, that...
Thank you.
I suppose one of the themes that's kind of come up in my short career is kind of a disconnect between the realities here in Ottawa of the public service and the realities both culturally and just in practice and daily life in Indigenous communities across the country. And I personally believe that there's an opportunity for young public administrators entering in their career and even at the undergraduate master's level to reach out and to take training about the realities in these areas, but also to do intercultural exchanges and actually have the opportunity to meet other young leaders and young people from these regions. And I was just wondering what your opinion on that is and how you think we can make it more of a common practice, I suppose you would say, for young public administrators to really reach out to communities from all three coasts.
Hello, anybody want to take that on? Kim.
I would say that there's probably, I'd say there's probably ample opportunity
to do that. I think that if there was a way for communities to invite us rather than us Southerners inviting ourselves, you know, there would be a platform for that. I think that's perfectly doable, but it would require that the community wanting that kind of experience be able to invite us to their homes.
I totally agree with that. One, there are mechanisms where we can do the placement within an Aboriginal organization of a public servant, if that is something that is agreeable to them for a few months, and we can do the switch on the other side also. One of the important things that we've started to do in my department is to target more Indigenous students to come in to work for the department during the summer or for longer times, which we haven't been very good at making effective.
Thank you. I just mentioned too, people might not be aware, there are a number of universities in public policy and public admin who are starting to ensure that there is a greater fabric running throughout the program that introduces public admin grad students to Indigenous issues. It's far from being great yet, so get out there and the students here in the room, pressure your universities to make sure that those programs are really solid. Because my one personal opinion is that I think that that is absolutely foundational learning for public admin students and public policy students. So where's our next question coming from? We've got a gentleman here would like the microphone.
Hello, good evening. My name is Roger Farley. I work now at the University of Ottawa, but I'm just here by myself. I was in federal government for 25 years, and I work for the Royal Commission on Aboriginal People also. So I have two questions. So for Kim and Paul, I was at the Royal Commission on Aboriginal People 20 years ago, and I would like to know, from your perspective, what's different now with the commission, the new report, and what was done 20 years ago, in terms of, political willingness to implement the recommendations? So, first question. Second is that you talk about the training, so policy development, policy implementation. And I remember when I traveled with the commissioners 20 years ago, I was in an Inuit community in Labrador, and that was a change in the entrance policy, unemployment policy at the time. And I remember that the people saying to the commissioners, like, this policy has been developed without our input. And so they stopped the unemployment payments. I think that was around May 15, because normally the fishermen can go fishing at that time. But in that place in Labrador, still ice. So policy was developed without thinking about the fact that people can live a different situation. So what can we do in public service in terms of mandatory training for policy people or program people so that not only they have they know that there's Aboriginal communities that have different needs, but how they can develop policies and come to the point that Hubert made. When we develop policy, we listen, then we go into our room, we develop something, then it goes to cabinet, and there's no dialogue for a long, long period of time. So how can we break that cycle so that with mandatory training and maybe a change in how we develop policies? So your thought.
Well, which one of you wants to go first? Paul, we still have you?
I guess first of all, Marshall, I just want to say on behalf of, I think, almost every employee in my department, I just want to say thank you very much for your contributions to RCAP. And I say that because, and I hope you're glad to hear this, that document is alive and well in our department in terms of guiding principles for how we move forward. Manifested in a number of ways, including by our minister, who recently went over to an event in Winnipeg in the celebration of the 20th anniversary. And in my weekly conversations with her, there's always a reference to RCAP. And so it's almost like it's still our Bible in a way. So please know that it's alive and well in terms of moving forward, in terms of not the actual recommendations, but the spirit thereof. In terms of helping us in terms of that reconciliation agenda. In terms of your second question, I think there's a lot going on in the space that you reference. The Kano School is moving forward in terms of our curriculum. We're working with the Kano School. So in terms of that that training for federal public servants in the Indigenous space, in order to be a little bit more culturally aware, a little bit more sophisticated in terms of the consultation, that's more respectful, resetting that tone of engagement. So that's a good thing. So that's what I would call the bottom-up contribution. And I think, and most importantly, we're also getting it at the top based on the announcement on December 15th in terms of the one-year anniversary, in terms of what the Prime Minister announced in terms of the reconciliation framework for the for how we develop policies going forward in the Indigenous space, which is co-development. So what specifically said was, once a year, he will meet with the representatives of on a distinct NAO, in distinct basis, creation of distinct permanent dialogue, bilateral mechanisms with the AFN, with the Métis, with the Inuit, and a co-development of their agendas and their priorities. And depending upon what those priorities are, he will bring the relevant cabinet ministers into that room to talk that through and develop action plans. And then underpinning that over the course of the year until the next meeting is cabinet ministers are required to meet 2 to 3 times a year with those NAOs in terms of going through progress, and assistant deputy ministers responsible are supposed to meet four times a year with each of them. So that's 12 meetings mandatory that came out of that cabinet decision on the reconciliation framework. That's extremely exciting, because that will start, as that reconciliation framework unfolds within the federal public service, a real change in dynamics in terms of how we engage on public policy formulation, not just the direct impact on public policies that they are asking for, but indirectly as well, as we regain, or as we try to get that, what I would call that tissue or muscle within the public policy space of how do we do this right in terms of any policies that directly or indirectly engage with Indigenous people. So I'm very excited about the future.
Kim, did you want to respond to
that? I think there's a lot's happened in the last 20 years. There's no question about it. We have more Indigenous entrepreneurs, graduates, doctors, you name it. There's a lot of evidence if you want to look for it. You know, the run of the Aboriginal Healing Foundation, the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. So there's been a lot of evidence that there's been some net forward gain over the last 20 years. And by the same token, you can find a lot of evidence that perhaps things haven't changed all that much. Our young people are still committing suicide in inordinate numbers. Our children are still at risk. Our water, I mean, basic human rights, like access to water, still not being met. So, you know, it depends on which angle you want to take. So yes, I would say there's been that forward gain, and some places we're really stalled. How do we write it better? How do we get to policy maintenance in a way that is respectful? Well, you don't just engage to develop policy, but you engage at every phase of the way. You allow for that policy then, when it is adopted, to be reviewed in exchange, in a bilateral process. When it's implemented, then it's monitored and evaluated bilaterally. And with the announcement of the Federal Law and Policy Review, we have that opening, an opening that is unlike anything we've ever seen, where we're actually going to have a place at the monitoring and evaluation table that says, no, look, the additions, specific claims policy, for example, should not extinguish rights, but we look to legislation to reinforce rights. So I think it's more of an iterative process at every stage, not just in policy development, but throughout adoption, implementation, and towards maintenance, there should be bilateral engagement all along.
Next question.
Hi, Lisa Alger. I'm a Swampy Cree First Nations woman from Northern Manitoba, and I'm also a public servant, a senior public servant. And I guess my question is to all of the panel. When you look at the
the real, true goals of reconciliation. Do you feel that that is actually possible in an environment where there's such an imbalance of power currently? Or do we need to have some changes in terms of that relationship and Indigenous people having more of a decision-making role in the kinds of things that affect our lives? And because we're in a forum where we're talking about public services and fonction publique, it's important to think about that, because I don't know that everybody recognizes when we're talking reconciliation that it's very difficult to have the same conversation at the same level when you're always the client of the system.
Mm-hmm. Maybe you
should
start us off on that one.
You've
been doing some deep thinking about this.
I think my simple answer is no. A reconciliation is possible with the current creative balance of power. I think that's what I'm alluding to when I talk about decolonization. I don't use that word lightly. We live in a really strange time when Jody Wilson-Raybould and others in Canada talk about decolonization at AFN meetings. And yet we seem to be completely unable to square up to it as part of what the fabric of the country is. It's a settler colonial state. This is not, this shouldn't really be news anymore. I'm not a public servant, and I would love to hear from others here, not just on the panel, but the answer to, you know, responding to your question. What do people in public service do if we recognize this power balance? You know,
Hubert? Yep, you're right.
Will it work if I speak?
Yep.
Yeah.
No, it's working.
Yeah. Thank you. So, because of the suit I'm wearing, I suppose I'm a little more optimistic than Aaron.
You forgot the tie.
And I guess the answer to your question is within your question. I'll share maybe not answering your question, but a little experience, which is emblematic of the issue that you're trying to address. I'm responsible for a little program that funds community initiatives in support of Indigenous languages. It's a small, very small program, which has lots of improvements needed, to say the least. One of the traps we've been falling into for the past 20 years, I guess, with this little program, which hasn't been increased in 20 years, is the assessment of the projects we receive, which too often lead to a call that the organization applying doesn't have enough capacity. Therefore, we don't fund it. And we've been encouraged by a system which is based on evaluations that mean, you know, not enough results, not enough capacity, and it's kind of self-perpetuating. And we have to get out of this cycle, whereby the capacity is built, and also the responsibility, and this is, I guess, the big challenge that we have with the future legislation. We have to create something with a sharing of responsibility and, in some instances, a devolution of responsibility. So that's where we have to go.
Hello. And hello, welcome, David. I didn't see the switch happen. Kim.
So poverty is socially created, and the Norwegians have it right. They have very fair resource revenue sharing agreements with the Sami, and everyone seems happy with that. So when I think about reconciliation, and I think I'm going to pose this challenge to everyone in this room, as the average Canadian, what are you willing to sacrifice for reconciliation? guaranteed representation in parliament, guaranteed representation on the municipal councils. How will we as a country institutionally protect and guard Indigenous cultures and languages? How will we change our cities to reflect that we actually exist now, today? So it does require a transfer of wealth, a transfer of resources. And, you know, much of the energy development that will happen in Canada over the next 2 to 3 decades will happen on Crown land to which we have title and to which, or which we own. So, you know, that conversation is going to get a lot more tense before it gets better. And with free, prior, and informed consent becoming part of the Canadian popular discourse, you know, we're going to be in this conversation in a very heated way over the next decade for sure, and perhaps beyond. So it requires an enormous transfer of wealth. Reconciliation at its base requires an enormous transfer of wealth. Is everybody in this room prepared to make that sacrifice?
There you go, David. Welcome to the panel. Give me my chance to warm up.
Yeah. And hello, everyone. And those are good points that you raise, and that's all, I mean, why we're having this conversation going forward, so that Canadians are talking about this from coast to coast to coast. The issue of power imbalance, I know certainly that's something I think we all have to be mindful of. And I know that what we're seeing is certainly at INAP, where we do have a lot of interactions with Indigenous groups across the country in our different regional offices as well, is we're seeing our staff go to different departments. And that's kind of part of the, you know, the awareness of what the reality is and the relationships with Indigenous peoples. And so this, and we made allusion to it earlier as well, educating public servants through the Canada School, making sure that people are aware of what the reality is out there. And I think it's moving forward and having these conversations.
Thanks. And I don't know if that one back here wanted to get in.
Thank you.
I don't see arms waving on this side, so, but there's a pole in the way, so please let me know if you need to get in.
Sorry, I'm Cindy Hansen from University of Regina, and I understand this session is about capacity to build on reconciliation, and I really appreciate ideas around working in communities, and I do think that universities are spending a significant amount of attention to reconciliation, which I'm very sort of leery about some of that, but that's another story. I also appreciate comments about, you know, forward gains and the TRC, and the concerns I have are around the IAP, and the IAP is the independent assessment process, which is part of the Indian Residential School Settlement Agreement. I'm sure most of you know that, but there are two things around the IAP in terms of policy development that I think draw certain alarm bells, and I think point to a need for closer scrutiny on policy development. And one is sort of around the essentialized notion of Indigenous, assuming that all Indigenous people understand things in the same way and come from the same language base and the same cultural base and the same place base, etc. And the other one is around gender. I did a gender analysis of the IAP and met with 23 survivors, and what I found is that, for example, in the way the compensations were assessed, if someone was lost a job and couldn't hold a job and could prove that their inability to hold on to a job as a result of the abuses they suffered at residential schools was linked, then they'd get more and more compensation. However, if someone was unable to parent effectively and lost their children to the child welfare system, there is no compensation. So if you look at that in terms of gender analysis, you'll see that clearly women are treated differently than men in terms of the way that policy was developed. What also frightens me in terms of where that's going is we're talking about reconciliation, and the IEP involved more than 50% of living survivors, if you use the stats that exist. So we're talking about over 38,000 people who came forth with claims, and that most of those claims will be destroyed, and that, in fact, if all the claims are destroyed, except the odd one, that maybe some survivor might understand what it means to make that public, even if it's redacted or whatever. If those claims are destroyed, how can we build reconciliation on a history that doesn't exist?
Thank you very much for the comments and for the information and analysis. I'm not sure, is anybody here who feels that they can respond to any of those points?
So our legal counsel is ensuring that it is left to the survivors to choose whether or not their stories and records are destroyed. So we are challenging the automatic destruction of those records to allow for families and or individuals impacted to choose. So that's all that I have. Our legal counsel is dealing with this issue.
Thank you. Do you have anyone else?
I can respond to that.
Yes, I'd like for you to
respond. I think that there's a real need for survivors to be able to understand that
and to understand what that means, because I think to assume that survivors are going to come forward and say, I'd like to make my record public, that's not going to happen. And it's not going to be lawyers that are telling them, you know. So I think it needs to be much bigger.
Absolutely.
Campaign, if you like.
And that would be, the department. That would be the department's responsibility to do that, to communicate that.
But, I mean, you just sort of back to the broader sort of policy discussion, you raise some really very important points of analysis that need to be brought into the conversation for, you know, whoever is putting these proposals and developing the policy on the table. Thank you very much. Sorry, I had another hand up. Pass the poll. First person on your left.
Ella Kessler, New Guam, Clayley, New Guam, Clayley, Takis, Quayalt Clan. My name is Sarah Chauvin from the Quayalt Nation on the west coast of Canada. And language has been mentioned many times tonight. And I commend our young Prime Minister on the move to create an Indigenous Languages Act. However, our time is short. We have many languages across this land that are on a great precipice that are ready to fall off. And so we are our language. Our people have been talking and crying out for many years for more support for our languages, to save them. And the development of policy in the Indigenous Languages Act, to me, is a wonderful move, but it sounds like it's going to take many years to get to that point. And many of our languages don't have years. So I think you say there's a duty to consult, but our people have been crying out for years. So I think that consultation has taken place. I also believe it's a human rights issue. English and French in this country get enormous, enormous amounts of funding and support across the land. Our children are put in schools where English is the main language spoken in BC, and very little is given over for our languages, even in our own band-run schools. And so, as cumbersome and lengthy as the process may be, what is being done in the meantime so that our languages don't fall off that process, precipice?
Thank you very much. Yvette, I don't know if it's possible for you to respond, but raises a very valid point. The legislative process within government can take a long time, and there's no guaranteed outcome once it gets to the floor of Parliament. is the department considering, or is government considering, any kind of sort of interim measures that can support the objectives of language protection or support in the meantime?
Thank you for the question. The short answer is yes. Now, I'm not going to share decisions that have yet to be made beyond my desk, if you see what I mean. But your very points have been made loud and clear by all the stakeholders and the experts that we have already consulted, because as you see, there's been consultation. There was a report 10 years ago by a group of language experts. So, yes, language can take some time, even though we're going to try to make it happen as quickly as possible. In the meantime, we're totally conscious that other things need to happen without waiting for the legislation to be brought forward and to bear fruits, because an act in itself is important, but in order for it to be implemented and bear fruits, also takes some time.
And
we've
got time for at least one more question.
Just a quick question, what's the name of the language report?
It was a task force in 2008. Thank you, Brian. Okay, 2005. The Aboriginal Language Task Force report, I think this means, or something like that.
So
there
was someone here who had their hand up. Oh, they're going here. Up all over the place. He promised them back there. Go ahead.
Bonjour, Odena Kwe Ndishin Kaas, Kebo Wekna Donjaba, Wabijesh Ndodam. My name is Shira Barberstock. I'm an academic, so I'm doing my master's at Queen's University. My research is actually exploring whether or not Indigenous entrepreneurs can contribute to reconciliation with the types of partnerships that they forge. So I'm very happy to be here. I'm also an entrepreneur myself. And one of the inspirations I've had recently, and I wanted to share is, I know there's always a lot of emphasis put on the government, and there's such a huge role to be played there. But I think there's such a wonderful opportunity that can be played with Indigenous, especially Indigenous businesses. Government can't do everything overnight, but when we're talking about revitalizing languages, why not work closely with Indigenous entrepreneurs? Give them funding so that we can create apps. Give us funding so we can create games. Give us funding so that we can set up really special programs where people can stay and live for a period of time with the people that have the language to teach them. So I just wanted to share that. I think there's a whole other element that we need to look at, and that's supporting our Indigenous entrepreneurs, because they can play a very special role in this whole process in partnership.
Thank you very much. Great. Another gentleman down here.
Good evening. My name is Christopher Miller. I'm a fairly new public servant as well. I currently work at Indigenous Northern Affairs, but tonight I'm here on my own account. And it's just a question for the panel in general. And I hear a lot of what the Prime Minister has been saying and what's been going on and our mandates of and that sort. And I'm just wondering, what kind of advice can you give to a public servant such as myself, who's recently joined the service, who comes from a lot of educational background and grown up and understands a little bit more than my predecessors of the Aboriginal and Indigenous situation, how can I become more patient with the progress which is going forward? I'm beginning to get sort of frustrated and I'm tired of being ashamed of my country's development and treatment of fellow Canadians, and I don't want to be ashamed anymore. I don't want to stop being frustrated, and I don't want to be seeing a lot of sort of the lines coming out of, oh, be patient, or we need to wait for direction, or we're going to have some more dialogue before making decisions. So in general, I know it's probably going to be, you need to be patient, these things take time, but from the panel, what advice do you have for a gentleman such as myself?
Oh, Kim wants to go.
There's a lot of policy positions opening up at the Assembly.
Policy and strategic direction.
Welcome to the department. So I've been in the government for 20 years, and so that tells you a little bit something, but I've only just arrived at INAC. And so, and Paul alluded to this earlier, that all public servants should have an opportunity to work at a department such as INAC. We've always, as public servants, have been told, regardless of where you have been, you need to go to a central agency in order to gain the experience to be a really good public servant. But we haven't had that. We need to go to INAC. It's an exciting time to be. You might not see a lot of change happening, but you know, especially when it comes to Indigenous issues, 20 years ago, 10 years ago, 2 years ago, I think, and Kim might have views on that, but things are moving much faster than they were in the past. The fact that the Prime Minister has stated that this is a priority for this government, and not only has he said it, not only has he put it in his mandate letters to all ministers, he's actually meeting with the Indigenous organizations, and he plans to do that on a yearly basis going forward, and it trickles down into the system. I mean, we can't, and we've spoken about this as public servants, we don't have the answers for everything. We need to work with our Indigenous partners to move forward. There are some things that are moving forward quickly, but there are others that, you know, work still needs to be done. We need to engage and figure out, are we doing the right thing?
Kim, other than getting his resume?
there are many, many creative bureaucrats who have been able to move off of the policy development phase into policy adoption and implementation. My recommendation is find them and get them to mentor and coach you, because you too can become an effective bureaucrat, because many others have been in that space. They may not all be surrounding you and in your network, current network of conversation, but I think through IPAC you can find them.
Great. You bet. I'll go in order and we'll end with you.
No, I can just echo what David has said, and Kim also. I'm in a department that doesn't have Aboriginal issues as its main focus. I mean, we, for the first time in my 20 years in this department, have it amongst our top priorities. And that's by virtue of the Prime Minister making it a top priority, you know. And if I don't deliver, I'm going to pay for it. And so will my team. First time ever.
And Aaron, last word to you.
It might be my only practical suggestion of the night, but there is a working group amongst various levels of people in the civil service, public service, that's been meeting at INAC, and different departments are going to host it on a sort of cross-departmental work on Indigenous issues, broadly defined. And I think you should seek out those people. I know Mark Fonda at INAC, others in the research area, they're involved. I'm sure you'd be really welcome, and there's lots of room there for different voices.
Thank you very much. That's actually a great note to end on. And sadly, we have come to the end, and I want, on your behalf, to thank our panelists for a great conversation. And I hope it's just the start of not just more conversation and dialogue, but as Aaron echoed our elders' comments, reconciliation action, folks. Thank you. Back over to you.
A young academic, if you're a seasoned public servant, cross sectors, community, we have an opportunity in many ways unprecedented. And it is the ideas that will also bring new change. And so we are so grateful that you've joined us this evening for the first in a series of IPACs.
events to share your thoughts, your ideas, your knowledge, your experience as we move forward, and let that conversation continue. As I mentioned, check on the IPAC's website and the new dedicated website to this National Year of Dialogue, and for your ideas for other events. Many organizations who are here, departments, agencies, such as the Social Studies Research Council, we are all very, very committed to working together and to moving forward. And so you're welcome to connect with us at any time and share your ideas about how we can continue this. So, we continue our discussions for another little while, for the next half hour or so outside. So, have a lovely evening. Thank you.